Reye syndrome is caused by severe damage to mitochondria and manifests as acute non-inflammatory encephalopathy with selective hepatic dysfunction and with fatty infiltration of the viscera. Reye syndrome occurs mainly in children and it's a very severe condition with mean mortality rate of approximately 40%. Reye syndrome is caused by a combination of two pathogenic factors, by viral infection and by antipyretic drug, most commonly aspirin. And interesting fact that less than 0.1% of children who took aspirin developed Reye syndrome, but more than 80% of children diagnosed with Reye syndrome had taken aspirin in the preceding 3 weeks. And it should be noted that aspirin remains a mainstay of treatment for children with Kawasaki disease. Now about the mechanism of Reye syndrome. Initially, viral infection activates systemic immune response, including activation of Kupffer cells. Kupffer cells are liver macrophages, and once they are activated, they begin to massively produce pro-inflammatory cytokines, as tumor necrosis factor alpha and interleukin 1. These two cytokines are both well-known mediators of metabolic toxicity. They disrupt and cause severe alterations in metabolic pathways. And in relation to Reye syndrome, important that they inhibit b-oxidation of fatty acids in mitochondria. Another effect of pro-inflammatory cytokines is inhibition of cytochrome P450 enzymes. It's a very important feature because in some genetically predisposed patients, administration of drugs that are metabolized by cytochrome P450, even in therapeutic dosage, may cause severe side effects. Because recall that most drugs after intake undergo deactivation by cytochrome P450 enzymes. So with decrease in activity of these enzymes, deactivation rate decreases, and the concentration of the active metabolites of these drugs goes up, and this potentiates side effects, and at some point of drug accumulation, it would simply result in severe intoxication. The crucial concept is that because viral infection impaired mitochondrial detoxification function and also lipid metabolism in tissues, in such compromised state, organisms become very vulnerable for any possible subsequent injury by any exogenous factor. And in case of Reye syndrome, this exogenous factor is aspirin. Aspirin is a well-known mitochondrial poison. First of all, aspirin can induce opening of pores on inner mitochondrial membrane. This results in rapid increase in permeability of inner mitochondrial membrane, this phenomenon called mitochondrial permeability transition. Recall that in normal state, inner mitochondrial membrane is impermeable. So rapid increase in permeability leads to dramatic consequences. First of all, it causes uncoupling of oxidative phosphorylation that subsequently decreases cellular energy production and causes bioenergetic failure of the cell. Also, because mitochondrial matrix has higher proteins concentrations than cellular cytosol, once membrane becomes permeable, fluid is going by oncotic gradient from cytosol to mitochondrial matrix. This causes mitochondrial swelling that at some point results in rupture of both mitochondrial membranes. And the most dangerous substance that is released from mitochondria is cytochrome C that induces intrinsic apoptotic pathway. But also aspirin disrupts beta oxidation of fatty acids. The concept is that on the inner mitochondrial membrane located mitochondrial trifunctional protein that is actually a complex of three enzymes. These three enzymes catalyze three steps in beta oxidation of fatty acids. Initially, fatty acyl CoA is converted by acyl CoA dehydrogenase to an oil CoA, that subsequently converted by the first enzyme in mitochondrial trifunctional protein complex to 3-hydroxyacyl CoA. And 3-hydroxyacyl CoA is converted by 3-hydroxyacyl CoA dehydrogenase to 3-ketoacyl CoA, that is degraded by TLase to acyl CoA and acetyl CoA. It turns out that aspirin metabolites have similar structural features with normal substrates of 3-hydroxyacyl CoA dehydrogenase. So basically they are competitive inhibitors of this enzyme. So instead of, for example, 4 fatty acids, enzyme degrades only 2, and another 2 fatty acids will remain in the tissues. And the problem is that anyway accumulated 3-hydroxyacyl CoA fatty acids must be degraded. And in this case, degradation occurs by omega-oxidation in endoplasmic reticulum. The final products of omega-oxidation are long-chain 3-hydroxydecarboxylic acids. With time, this results in accumulation of a substantial amount of fatty acids. And it was determined that in patients with Reye syndrome, the level of decarboxylic acids increased to such extent that they make up approximately 55% of total serum fatty acids. So aspirin inhibit normal beta-oxidation of fatty acids in mitochondria. This results in increase in omega-oxidation with accumulation of decarboxylic acids. And the problem is that decarboxylic acids in such massive quantity are toxic for mitochondria, because as aspirin they induce mitochondrial permeability transition, and as we know, mitochondrial permeability transition leads to a cellular death. Also, we see that all these pathological changes occur to turn serious insult to mitochondria. So Reye syndrome affects all tissues that have mitochondria, and the higher is mitochondrial quantity, the more severe is the damage to the tissue. First of all, because normal mitochondrial beta-oxidation is disrupted, fatty acids begin to progressively accumulate in tissues, and histologically it manifests as fatty infiltration of the viscera, which is the first signature feature of Reye syndrome. The most pronounced damage occurs to liver tissue, because liver tissue has very high quantity and density of mitochondria. And in Reye syndrome, viral infection combined with aspirin damage cause severe insult to mitochondria that results in decrease in hepatocytes energy production. And in energy deficient state, liver tissue cannot maintain its metabolical and synthetic activity. And also viral infection inhibit activity of cytochrome P450 enzymes, thereby decrease liver detoxification function. And overall, because massive amount of hepatocytes die, liver tissue becomes less functionally capable. That's why the second characteristic feature of Reye syndrome is selective hepatic dysfunction. And because of hepatic dysfunction, liver ability to extract ammonia from the blood decrease, and this causes increase in blood ammonia level that causes development of acute non-inflammatory hepatoencephalopathy, which is the third signature feature and certainly the most clinically important manifestation of Reye syndrome. Basically, it's a typical hepatic encephalopathy, but with very fast progression rate. Briefly, a large amount of ammonia in the brain tissue causes astrocyte swelling that results in cerebral edema. Cerebral edema causes increase in intracranial pressure, this condition called intracranial hypertension. Increased intracranial pressure triggers Cushing reflex that results in Cushing triad, its increase in blood pressure, bradycardia, and the most important, irregular breathing pattern. Because intracranial pressure compresses brainstem, and in brainstem located centers that control involuntary breathing, compression of brainstem disrupts normal function of respiratory centers, and exactly this disrupts normal breathing. Also, intracranial hypertension causes neurological symptoms as headaches and vomiting. With progressive increase in intracranial pressure, more severe neurological symptoms appear, as confusion, coma, and seizures. But the most important is that the higher becomes intracranial pressure, the more severe becomes breathing dysfunction. And at some point, intracranial pressure becomes so high that it causes herniation of the brainstem that culminates in apnea. And obviously, prolonged apnea results in death. And exactly brainstem dysfunction is the most common cause of death in Reye syndrome. In terms of laboratory findings, central concept is that in Reye syndrome, liver is severely injured. Because massive amount of hepatocytes die, intracellular enzymes are released into the blood, so it causes increase in blood alanine and aspartate aminotransferase level. Also, because liver produce most coagulation factors for both extrinsic and intrinsic apoptotic pathways, liver damage results in decrease in synthesis of coagulation factors. This causes prolongation of activated partial thromboplastin time and prothrombin time. Also, in Reye syndrome, lactic acidosis develops. The concept is that in normal condition, liver is the main consumer of lactate. Liver consumes approximately 30 to 70% of lactate acid from the blood. Hepatocytes uptake lactate from the blood and convert it to pyruvate and then to glucose. Basically, this process is called gluconeogenesis. And with liver injury, hepatocytes quantity decreases, thereby intake of lactic acid decreases, and this results in elevation of lactic acid level in the blood. And lactate makes blood pH more acidic, so that's how lactic acidosis develops. Also, in Reye syndrome, hypoglycemia develops. Hypoglycemia develops due to two reasons. First of all, because with decrease in hepatocytes, gluconeogenesis decreases, and also because hepatocytes regulate insulin level. They uptake insulin and thereby they decrease insulin level in the blood. This process called hepatic insulin clearance. In the blood, insulin transfers glucose from blood compartment into the tissue compartment. Thereby, insulin decreases blood glucose level. When severe liver injury occurs, insulin clearance by hepatocytes decreases, so insulin level in the blood increase, and the higher is insulin level, the higher is glucose exit into the tissue compartment, so the lower becomes glucose level in the blood. But interesting that in children with Reye syndrome, jaundice does not develop, and actually it's one of the most important diagnostic features. The way to think about this is that actually bilirubin level increased, but not to the levels that manifest as jaundice. And as we know, jaundice as a clinical symptom becomes evident when bilirubin level becomes greater than 2.5 to 3 mg per deciliter or 40 to 50 micromol per liter. And in Reye syndrome, bilirubin does not exceed these values. So Reye syndrome somehow resembles drug-induced liver injury, where liver damage do not necessarily cause significant bilirubin elevation. Also from this picture is clear that if child has pre-existing metabolic disorder, particularly primary or secondary beta-oxidation defects, as inherited deficiency of medium-chain acyl dehydrogenase or long-chain acyl-CoA dehydrogenase deficiency, such disorders predispose mitochondria to any injury. So in this case, even viral infection without aspirin intake will cause severe mitochondrial damage. And in this case, aspirin intake will serve as additional factor that will only exacerbate mitochondrial injury. And because all Reye syndrome symptoms are caused due to mitochondrial injury, in child with primary beta-oxidation defect, damage that is provoked just by viral illness is enough to cause the same clinical picture as in child without any metabolic disorder, where injury is provoked by a combination of viral illness and aspirin intake. And from this perspective, when symptoms of severe mitochondrial injury, let's call them Reye symptoms, develops in child with inherited metabolic disorder, such condition called Reye-like syndrome. And if Reye symptoms develops in child without any pre-existing metabolic disorder, such condition considered as classical Reye syndrome.